Thank you. Thanks for the invitation to talk at this conference. Especially for me, it's a great pleasure because it's also in celebration of my good friend Ron, Ron's 60th birthday. So I'm going to talk about TT star geometry. This is a subject that I have worked on over the past 26 years, but not continuously. So I'm going to review some aspects of it from old work and some things from the new work that I've been doing in this. Now, giving a talk to a math audience, as this audience is mostly about, is very tough for a physicist, as you might realize. But I think that I made it by the fact that probably you have heard some physics talks in the past, so your expectation is not very high. So I think the expectation of having being able to understand everything I'm saying is probably maybe not too realistic in some ways, but at least I hope that I can convey some of the ideas that are relevant in this story. So that's my aim. I've tried to make it as mathematical as I can, but I'm sure I have not succeeded quite, but we'll see how far I get. So so again, this is, as I said, this based on work which I've done over many years with Sergio Cecotti. This is from old, like early 90s. And also two recent work which I'm going to emphasize, say basically 2 years and a year ago work, related to extensions of this, so it's kind of an extension of these new things that are happening in the context of topological string and other quantum field theories. So the goal for my talk is the first part I'm going to review the old story. What is the old story arose in two-dimensional quantum field theories in the context of 2,2 supersymmetric theories. I discussed this and I talked about the relation of this to hyperholomorphic connections. Then I talk about the extensions of this to 3- and 4-dimensional supersymmetric quantum field theories. And these relate to theories which have 4 total supercharges in the physics language, which means 3-dimensional quantum field theories with n equal to 2 supersymmetry, or 4-dimensional quantum field theories with n equals to 1 supersymmetry. In the 3-dimensional example, I give connections of these, the objects that arise in this context, to monodromies that have been studied, like S and T matrices of Chern-Simons theory. So there's a connection with Chern-Simons theory here. And then I talk about the relation of these to 4-dimensional n equal to 2 theories. And this is interesting for a number of reasons. First of all, it makes contact with topological strings. And in fact, it gives you a highly non-trivial extension of topological strength, which we call the twistorial topological strength. So I try to explain to you what this twistorial topological strength is. It makes contact between topological strength and the ideas of Concevich and Soibelman in terms of wall crossing phenomena of the what we call the BPS state. And also it connects to the hyperkähler geometry described in this context by Gaeta, Moore, and Nitzky. So this kind of TT star kind of unifies all these things together into one framework: topological strings, wall crossing, hyperkähler geometry, as well as these other ones. And that's what I've been trying to describe. There are many things that have to be developed further in this context. It's by no means a finished story, but at least it has a story that has started, and I've tried to explain some aspects of it. So the hyperkähler geometry really is something that is also, I know, dear to Ron's heart, is kind of connecting all of these things in some way together. So I start with that general background about what are the aspects of these theories, which may be useful here, perhaps, for people who haven't seen any of this before. So quantum field theories. What is quantum field theories, you might ask? Okay, we just say, for the purpose of this talk, quantum field theory in this context has certain ingredients. First of all, there's a Hilbert space. You fix a Hilbert space. There's a set of linear operators in this action of this Hilbert space. And then there are some expectation values that you compute, which you can think about is this acting on some specific states, and you compute its expectation value. So this is what we call correlation functions. And then there's a parameter space in these theories, which is for which these correlation functions vary as a function as objects, as you change the points on the parameter space. And the thing is, the quantum field theories have these generally axiomatic structures you can put and various other things I haven't talked about, but it's very difficult to compute. So basically, we just have axioms, but we don't have any single example, really, at least very few examples in higher dimensional space where we can actually compute them exactly. So it's very hard to do anything, really, except for specific classes of theories where we call, which are supersymmetric quantum field theories. And in these cases, we can do some things completely, in other words, we can compute things, certain things exactly. For example, there's a subspace of the Hilbert space, which I call H0, typically finite dimensional, sometimes could be infinite dimensional, which is the space of ground states of the theory. So this the lowest energy states of the theory. And it's interesting to study the space because they are kind of, the stable part of your theory. Things decay to them, but these are the stable part, these are the vacuum. And in some cases, the dimension of this Hilbert space, the ground state, doesn't change, so it's stable. In fact, it's like protected by an index theory type argument. When that happens, when you have enough supersymmetry, this dimension is fixed. So in supersymmetric theories with enough supersymmetry, the ground states, this Hilbert space, the subspace, are defined by some, you can think of it as elements of some cohomology theory. So there is an operator in your Hilbert space, the analog of a D operator, you can think of it. I call it Q, which squares to zero. And you can think about the cohomology elements of this Q as being related to ground states. In fact, more is true that there is also an adjoint of the analog of Q, like just like D dagger, the adjoint of Q, and the actual ground states are killed by both Q and Q dagger. So this is like the analog of the harmonic forms. So you can think about the ground states I'm talking about as an analog of harmonic forms that you're familiar with in the Durand theory. So we have Q and Q dagger, and we want to study this ground state, the space of these states which are killed by both Q and Q dagger. So the Hilbert space is you can think about it as a vector bundle over the space of, over the parameter space, which I'm denoting by M. There's a subspace in that Hilbert space I'm calling H0, which is the space of ground states. And this subspace, H0, will be moving around as we move on the points of the parameter space. And the interesting question is, what can we say about how this H0 moves around in this bigger Hilbert space? And this is this geometry of this bundle, H0 inside H, defines the geometry that I would like to study. In physics, we call this the study of the connection that this induces, we call Berry's connection. And it's basically the study of this the bundle, H0 subspace of H, as you vary over the parameter space. And this naturally gives you a connection because you can take elements of this space and you take the variation, you take the operator acting on it, as the subspaces change, you can use the inner product in the Hilbert space to get a natural connection there. And we would like to know something about how this connection, aspects of this connection. That's the name of the game here. In many cases of interest, and in particular for two-dimensional quantum field theory with this much supersymmetry, this turns out to be a holomorphic vector bundle. This H0 bundle I talked about is a holomorphic vector bundle. The parameter space is a complex space, and you have a holomorphic vector bundle on it. And this is related to the fact that the theory admits two different topological twistings, and one can view it as holomorphic twisting and the other one as anti-holomorphic twisting, where Q or Q dagger play the role of D operator, del or del bar operator, accordingly. So we are interested in computing this connection, and various kinds of tools can be used to compute this connection. Topological twisted quantum field theories and localization arguments of path integrals, etc., that I won't go through, but I'll just basically give you schematics of what are the relevant objects appearing. So we are describing theories in two-dimensional field theory, which means the space is two-dimensional. So take a space to be like this cigar geometry. So you'll have a boundary. So just the general axiomatics of quantum field theory tells you that if you do the path integral on a space, you get a state on the boundary, localized on the boundary. So, So in general, you can put operators in the middle and do the path integral, and you get the state on the boundary. And the state that you get can be defined if you're doing a topological version of the path integral. You get elements of this of the ground state H0, which are well defined up to Q trivial states. In other words, this defines, you can use this to define Q cohomology classes by depending on what operators you insert here, you get different cohomology elements. So there's this one-to-one correspondence between choices of good operators and the elements of this cohomology, elements of this cohomology space. To get the actual ground state, not just representatives of the cohomology, but the analog of the harmonic forms, if you want to get the actual harmonic forms in this context, you have to take the cigar geometry and infinitely lengthen it. So the path integral projects it to the ground state here. This is the usual argument if you think about this as time. The time evolution in this direction is e to the minus beta h, the Hamiltonian, and you're going to project to the ground state. So you naturally get strictly ground state elements if this is long enough neck. So strictly we take beta goes to infinity and this becomes a projection onto the actual ground state. And to compute inner products, we just take two pieces of this cigar and connect them to a sphere, and you put the operators left and right, and this gives you the inner product in the Hilbert space in this form. So this we can do for the topologically twisted theory. So we can put holomorphic what we call chiral fields on the left and on the right, and this gives you the inner product between these states. But in the topologically twisted theory, we have two different choices of the twisting we can do, where we put chiral fields, this is the holomorphic one, or anti-chiral fields, which are complex conjugate of these guys. So this theory and this part are literally complex conjugate of one another. So once you know one of them, you know the other one. So it's kind of boring, we just talk about one of them. But then there's something you can do, which is a mixture of them. You can take the left one to be holomorphic and the right one to be anti-holomorphic. This is somewhat strange. Usually we talk about holomorphic objects or anti-holomorphic objects. This mixes them. So it's crucial for TT star geometry to mix the holomorphic and the anti-holomorphic object into one object. The reason this is called the TT star is that topological piece and anti-topological piece, or holomorphic and anti-holomorphic, come together. So the topological twisted, using topological twisted theory, we can come up with interesting ring structures in this context. So as I said, there's a relation between a state and an operator, but you can act on the state that you get out of putting an operator beta here. You can act on it with another chiral field phi alpha on the left. But then that you can also take inside, because that's also related to putting an operator inside. So I can take phi alpha and view it as an operator inside. But then the operator part of the expansion of the corner field theory tells you that you can take the product of two operators and replace it by another operator, which is given by the three-point function on the sphere of three chiral fields, and we call C alpha beta gamma with some inner product, which is denoted by eta. So in other words, you have more than just the relation, the correspondence between operators and states, you also get a ring structure, which is somewhat analogous to a cohomology ring. So just like you have a cohomology ring in manifolds, you also get the cohomology ring here. So this is very much in parallel to what you might have seen in that context. Except these objects are not just numbers, these are parameters which could vary over the complex manifold. So they are some kind of a deformation is allowed here. In fact, these structure constants of this ring, which are holomorphic quantities, and they can be viewed as sections of the cotangent bundle on the parameter space, times the endomorphism, tensor with the endomorphism of this bundle. And this is because you can use each of these chiral fields and add it to the action, so that corresponds to a deformation of the space. So in other words, one of the indices here, this one, can be viewed as an element of the cotangent space, and the other one can be viewed as an endomorphism. So you can reinterpret this object, the chiral ring, as in this form. Now, in some cases that one is familiar with in this context, and probably some of you may have seen it in the context of, for example, Landau-Ginzburg theories, when you have a superpotential given by some parameter, by some polynomial W of some fields phi, the ring is called is related to the ring generated by these monomials C of phi modulo the ideal generated by the gradients of W. So this is an analog, an example of this kind of the ring we study when you have some, let's say, some polynomial could be called homogeneous or some deformations thereof. You can come up with some kind of a ring structure, and the structure constants of this ring are related to these C's when you choose a basis for them. In some cases, depending on what W you choose and so forth, this could be related to quantum cohomology ring or mirror of the quantum cohomology ring of the, for example, for the Gromov-Witten theory. In some other cases, depending again what W you choose, this ring could end up being related to the Verlinde ring. All of these will arise in the examples I'm talking about. It's not just analogy. We can actually get all of these depending on what kind of examples we talk about. So these rings that we have seen in the various contexts in mathematical physics, that quantum cohomology rings are Verlinde rings and so forth, are examples of this structure. So now we come back to the main question, computation of the geometry of the bundle. So we have the bundle of this vacuum, H0, which varies over the parameter space, and we get a natural connection, and we want to study the bundle. This bundle, the first thing to do is to compute the inner product structure, so we compute it using TT star geometry, namely we divide the sphere to two halves, and we take the distance between the two halves to be infinitely far away, and we put chiral fields here, anti-chiral fields here, and these generate for us the inner product by just corresponding projection. On the left we get the alpha bar state, and on the right we get the beta, so we just get this inner product represented by this path integral. Unfortunately, the localization arguments of path integrals that are usually very powerful for topological strings is not enough to be able to enable you to actually compute this explicitly. So these are among the hard computations of supersymmetric theories, which we cannot do explicitly. So it's different from what we are used to in the context of, let's say, Gromov-Witten invariance or mirror symmetry, where we actually can replace the computation with very simple objects, relatively speaking. These are far harder to compute. Nevertheless, there is a structure that they are characterized by, and that we can say how they are characterized by. So we can say what characterizes them. What characterizes them is the following structure. So you consider the covariant derivative for this bundle, which is D plus the connection, and the holomorphic and the anti-holomorphic versions thereof. It turns out that these, of course, are not necessarily flat connections, because there's a non-trivial connection curvature for this bundle, so it's not, and that's precisely what we're trying to compute. But it turns out that there is a different connection, which is actually flat. Namely, we introduce a formal parameter, zeta. You can think of it as a formal parameter, zeta, complex parameter. And you modify this D by adding to it this C, which is related to the cotangent bundle tensor with the endomorphism, so you can think about this as a one form. This is the structure constant of that algebra as well. You can think of it as a kind of a connection. And you can add to this connection a multiple of that ring element times a form parameter zeta, so you're modifying the connection in this form. And similarly, for the anti-holomorphic part, you modify it by the inverse of this complex parameter. Oh, this should be barred here. These should both have bars in them, sorry. So these are the complex conjugate versions of the same thing, except the zeta is not zeta bar, it's zeta inverse. And the statement is that these connections are flat. So this, what we call this improved connection, is flat. And these give you a bunch of equations when you rewrite them in terms of different components. So you get terms involving zeta squared, zeta minus 2, and zeta to the 0th power, and you expand them, you get various set of equations. These equations are called the TT star equations. For the case that this is one-dimensional, if the marginalized space is one-dimensional, these equations can be written in a different way, which is perhaps more familiar in the math community. These are known as the Hitchens equations. So you think about the C as the, so you think about the parameter space M as like a Riemann surface. And the C, you can think about it as a one-form on this Riemann surface. What's called the Higgs field in the context of the Hitchin equation. And you have the Hitchin equation, which is basically the fact that this is covariantly constant, the covariant derivative is zero, and the curvature is given by the commutator of this field up to a sign. So these are the Hitchin's equations. And in that context, it's also known that the Hitchin equation can also be written in this form. So that's just a familiar fact in the context of Hitchin equation. And Hitchin's equations can also be viewed as a reduction of self-Toulié-Mills equations from four dimensions to two dimensions. So you think about a four-dimensional connection given by four components, A1, A2, A3, and A4. And you think about the connection to depend on two of the parameter space, which I'm calling M, and not to depend on the other two coordinates, 3 and 4. So if you write the self-Toulié-Mills connection, condition for self-Toulié-Mills connection, you get exactly these equations up here. So Hitchin's equation is known, as is well known, is just a reduction of self-Toulié-Mills from 4D to 2D, and that's what this equation is. Now, what is this zeta here? The zeta is a parameter which is also familiar from the study of instanton equations for four dimensions, which is the fact that self-Toulié-Mills equations can also be written two-storially, like Ward's construction and so forth. So you can describe it by introducing the twister parameter, and in the twister parameter, the equation simplifies, and it's the analog of these being flat in this reduction. So the existence of this parameter zeta can be interpreted as a twister sphere description of the self-Toulié-Mills equations in four dimensions, now reduced to two dimensions. So this is the analog of the case where we have a one-dimensional complex space for the parameter space. We get the Hitchin system. However, as I mentioned, there's no reason it has to be one-dimensional. N is n-dimensional complex space. So the TT star equation that I wrote down here is not just for one-dimensional space, for any n-dimensional space. So what happens there? Well, I'll come to it in a second. So just to finish the story about the four-dimensional case, one-dimensional M, which comes from the reduction of four-dimensional self-Toulié-Mills. In that case, this can be viewed, the statement of a self-Toulié-Mills equations can also be reformulated as saying that in four dimensions you have a hyperholomorphic connection, which means that you have a holomorphic connection with respect to all three complex structures. So that's a hyperholomorphic connection is another way of saying you have an instanton equation, self-Toulié-Mills in four dimensions. But phrasing it this way actually helps you to generalize. And it turns out that the equation that I wrote down for TT star equation can be interpreted in the following way. You start with a hyperholomorphic manifold of dimension 4n, real dimension 4n, and you take a reduction of it to 2n. So the example I was just talking about was n equals to 1, but more generally it's a 4n to 2n. The TT star geometry arises from studying hyperholomorphic connections in 4n dimensions. These are, again, holomorphic connections which are holomorphic with respect to all three complex structures of the Heiberg-Keller manifold. And you reduce them. It does not depend on 2n of the dimension of the variable. So you get the reduction to a 2n dimensional space. That is the TT star geometry. So TT star geometry is another way of saying this structure. So you take the 4n dimensional hyperholomorphic bundle, and the reduction of it is what TT star geometry gives. But it's natural to ask a little more questions. We have said TT star geometry gives you flat connections, but it's natural to ask, what is a section of that flat connection? It's a nice connection, so you might as well ask for flat section, for sections of that flat connection. So what is the meaning of these sections? For in the physics context, it turns out to be important to describe this, sections by introducing a boundary to your theory, to a two-dimensional space, and you have to put boundary conditions. And these boundary conditions depend on a choice of which supersymmetry you preserve. So You have two supersymmetries. You have n equal to 2 supersymmetry, and you have to choose a combination of that you keep fixed on the boundary as preserved. And so typically we choose angles, and let me define the zeta, which is e to the I theta, where theta is how you combine, which combination of those two charges you preserve at the boundary. And this zeta, in this language, it will be a phase. And the boundary condition you put in here is characterized by which phase you protect. You try to protect which combination you're protecting. And with some boundary data denoted by D here. The boundary data is itself gives you a state. So you can put the boundary data here, and the path integral will give you a state. So the inner product between the state produced by the path integral and the boundary condition you put in will give you an object, which turns out to be that section of the bundle we were interested in. So it turns out if you put the boundary data here, suitable boundary data that I will mention in a second, it turns out the objects that you get in this way are naturally flat sections of this flat bundle. And in this context, this phase has this parameter zeta, which previously was an arbitrary parameter, complex parameter, now has to be a root of unit, because it tells you which combinations of the two supersymmetries preserved. So an example of it is two-dimensional Landau-Ginzburg theories. So you take a polynomial, maybe, of some kind, of function of some variables, holomorphic function of some variables, xi, and you look at the critical points. So there are a bunch of critical points of the W. Let's say they're isolated. Let's assume they're isolated critical points. And these isolated critical points correspond to the ground states of the theory. And the chiral ring, as I said before, is just the ring generated by these X's modulo dW. And we get a natural ring structure, which we can write in the following way. You can take, you can choose, well, the ring acts in a natural way. You can take point bases, for example, for the ground states, and these correspond to the action for every monomial by just evaluating at the point. Now, what is the D-Brain state? What are these boundary conditions that I was telling you about? The boundary conditions are the Lagrangian submanifold obtained by the gradient flows relative to W. So if you look at the critical points of the W, and look at the gradient flows, holomorphic gradient flows for this holomorphic function W, they project onto the W plane. If you look at the map of X space to the W plane, the critical points will map the critical values here, and these Lagrangian spaces, which are these flows of this gradient flows of this W, will project with straight lines in W. If you change the phase, it turns out that these rotates, this WD rotates, and the plane that you get, the line that you get, rotates in the W plane as well. So in other words, the angle on the W plane is related to that phase. As you can see, again, it's natural to think about zeta as a phase. It's the phase in which it tells you how these Lagrangians project to the W plane, what phase do they take. Now you can ask, what is the relation between the pairing between the chiral fields and these Lagrangian spaces? I was telling you that you can compute these inner product. You take a chiral field, you take a boundary data, you take the inner product. Well, it's a natural guess what the answer has to be. You take e to the minus w and integrate over the cycle given by the d beta with when you insert the corresponding chiral field. This is a very natural thing to do, right? Take chiral fields here, you take e to the minus w and integrate it, and the cycle integration is such that this integral converges. That's precisely the fact that the w is semi-positive, it's a half line, and half line is such that this integral converges.
Can you divide?
Sorry?
Can you divide?
Yes, I have taken zeta to be 1, exactly. So here, for a given zeta, I have taken it zeta 1, but otherwise, as being pointed out here, there should be a zeta in the denominator. If W is quasi homogeneous, this indeed works. This turns out to be actually the correct answer. So for quasi homogeneous W's, this object turns out to be precisely the overlap that I was trying to compute. And For the Calabi-Yau case, these are familiar. These are just the periods of the Calabi-Yau. And the objects we talked about, the seas and all that, relate to variation of the heart structure and all that. So it's a familiar story in the context of Calabi-Yau. These objects arise. However, if W is not quasi-homogeneous, this doesn't work. It turns out that this overlap is far more complicated than overlap of integrals. So if we just take, for example, W is x cubed minus ax, and try to do the analog of what I told you by integrating e to the minus w, the integral makes sense. Everything makes sense, except it's the wrong answer. So what you would have thought is the right thing to do gives you the wrong answer. It's only for the quasi-homogeneous one that you get the right answer. In fact, computing these objects involves solving Pan-Levitt 3 equations, far more difficult than if this was, than exponentiation of this one being an answer. If e to the w was giving you the answer, you get solutions involving airy functions, which is far more trivial. So instead of airy functions, you're getting Pan-Levitt 3 equations that you have to solve. So the solution is far more complicated. However, the other object, this holomorphic object, its period-like integral, is so nice. Here I guess we store the factor of zeta that was being asked before. So that's the zeta will go there. But this object is so nice that you would like to say, is there a way to make this a solution? And in fact, there is. You see, the zeta that I was telling you about is naturally going to be a root of unity. So if you think about this as a sphere, it should be on the equator. However, you can take an asymmetric limit by taking zeta to be zero. You can take zeta towards zero. In that limit, the w part disappears, kind of. And you can show that the object that you compute ends up being the naive answer you would have expected. So the naive answer, this answer, is in some sense the degeneration of the good answer in some limit. You take, so the answer depends on a twisted parameter on a sphere. You take a north pole answer, and you get an answer you're familiar in the context of period integrals. But the general answer, when you don't do that, is a far more complicated object. It's not going to be easy to compute it, as I hope to convince you by explaining that it's connected to Pan-Levitt 3 equations. Okay, I think I have to speed up. Now, one aspect of the 3D star geometry is very strange, because I told you, you start with a Hilbert-Taylor manifold, you take a triholomorphic connections, and then reduce it. It's a bizarre thing. Why don't you get the same structure upstairs? Why don't we have the whole geometry, Hilbert-Taylor geometry, coming to life? Why not the hyperholomorphic bundle itself? Why are we having a reduction? And that's a good question. And that's part of the relation to some of the modern work in the context of 3D star. The hint is that, well, if you don't want a reduction, you have a more interesting physics, because you have more variables. And the hint from physics is that, well, you can go to higher dimensional theories. Higher dimensional theories and stuff, two-dimensional theories, are more interesting physically as well. So that turns out to be the answer. So if you go instead of two-dimensional to three- and four-dimensional quantum field theories, the geometry of the ground state bundle can also be studied. So here we talk about n equal to one supersymmetric theories in four dimensions, or n equal to two supersymmetric theories in three dimensions. Just like the 2,2 supersymmetric theories in two dimensions, they all have the same amount of total number of supercharges, namely four. So they all have four supercharges. So you can reduce this theory on a circle, you come to here. You reduce this theory on a circle, you can come down there. So they are related by circle reductions. So therefore, you could ask, if you study these theories, what are you going to get for the vacuum geometry of these theories, of the 3D and the four-dimensional quantum system here? So let me first talk about the three-dimensional case. If you study one of these three-dimensional cases, suppose you have a global symmetry in this theory of rank n. It turns out that in the three-dimensional theories with this much supersymmetry, for each global symmetry, for each rank of it, you get a twisted mass. So you're going to get n twisted masses for a rank n global symmetry. Moreover, to consider the space of vacuum, we put the theory on a compact flat dimension, two-dimensional space. So in one plus one dimension, we put everything on a circle. Here, we want to put everything on a flat space in two dimensions. Well, there's only one choice of flat space. There's two-dimensional torus. So put them in a flat torus. And we can turn on flat connections for this global symmetries. But you have a rank n bundle. So therefore, the flat connections are going to be 2n dimensional because you have two directions along the cycle. So you get a 2n dimensional space that way. But as I said, there's also a twisted mass. So you get a 3n dimensional space. And it turns out the geometry of the vacuum bundles can be studied in this context. And it gives rise to what's called the Bogomolny monopole equations, which is f equals to star d phi. So f phi can be viewed as an element of the adjoint, takes values in the adjoint, otherwise the scalar. And so this equation defines what's called the Bogomolny monopole equations. We can study this in the context of three dimensions first, if you take n equals to 1. So this is the Bogomolny monopole equation in three dimensions. And as you can see, we have now gone from two-dimensional Hitchin equation to a three-dimensional equation. So this can be viewed as an analog, a 3D analog of Hitchin equations. So indeed, it is, if you take a four-dimensional cell through Yang Mills and reduce it on a circle, you get this equation. So this is related to reduction of cell through Yang Mills, just like Hitchin equation was. But again, this is n equals to 1. And but you can generalize this to other dimensions as well, as I will namely, if you go to 4n dimension, instead of reduction to 2n, as it was the case in 2D, you end up getting reduction to 3n dimensional space of a hyperholomorphic geometry. So now we have actually raised the dimension by one unit upwards. Instead of 2n, we go to 3n. But you again have the same structure as the hyperholomorphic connections as describing the 2D star geometry. So the geometry now of the analog of the cigar is going to be the solid torus, where the boundary is the space where you put the where you base your Hilbert space, your vacuum on. And this is the relevant geometry generalizing the TT star geometry. However, there are some differences with the 2D case. In the 2D case, I told you that there's a one-to-one correspondence between putting operators, the chiral fields, and the states that you get. It turns out in the 3D case, there is a correspondence, but instead of point operators, you put line operators. So you don't have a one point, but over a whole line. And you have a geometry like this. So I'm now drawing the solid torus as a product of the cigar times a circle. And at one point on the cigar, if I put this circle over here, you wrap a line operator around it. This is similar to, for example, the contents of Chern-Simons theory. It's like a Wilson line operator. So you put an operator there, which is like a Wilson line operator, and you get this state. And then you get the analog of the operator, which was the chiral ring of that we are familiar for Landau-Ginzburg. You get the line operators. They have their own chiral ring, and they give you similar structures as we had before. But you see, the map between the ground state and line operator is no longer unique. This was, in the case of 2D, this was unique because for every state you put an operator, there's no choice here. But here, if I just start with a boundary torus, depends on which cycle of a torus I'm filling. I have choices to make. So it's not one-to-one anymore. You can choose one filling and define operators, but somebody else might have a different filling of the torus. So you get transformations between different ways of filling it. And in fact, these different ways of transformations gives you a map of the modular transformation of the torus acting on the spaces of the ground state. So out of nowhere, we are getting a modular transformation acting on the ground states. This structure is familiar for those of you who are familiar with Chern-Simons theory in the context of knot invariants and so on. But the theory I'm talking about is actually much more complicated than the Chern-Simons theory. It is not just topological. It depends on various parameters, and continuous parameters, and complex parameters, and all that, unlike the Chern-Simons theory. However, there's a limit of this theory, which gives you, in some cases, Chern-Simons theory back. Namely, you can take the metric in three dimensions and make it bigger and bigger and bigger. This is what we call in physics flowing in the infrared, or RG flow, renormalization group flow. So in the limit where you take this bigger and bigger, the theory becomes topological, and you flow to something like a Chern-Simons theory. So the structures that I'm telling you about here are, in some sense, can be viewed as a deformation of Chern-Simons theory. As you flow in the infrared to these points, you get points, sometimes they're trivial, sometimes they're Chern-Simons-like theories of different types, and you can kind of view this geometry that I'm telling you about as a deformation of the S and T matrices that you're familiar in the context of Chern-Simons to Thinkwich-dependent parameters. So it's an interesting story. So you get an extension of the Verlinde algebra, which now gets deformed, and deformed in a way which relates to hyperkähler geometry. For four-dimensional quantum field theories, when n equals to one supersymmetry, the parameter space on Tori come in multiples of, the parameters of the torus come in multiples of three or four, depending on which theory we're dealing with. So sometimes you get 3n-dimensional space, sometimes you get 4n-dimensional space. So, for example, in four-dimensional n equals to one, you have sometimes tensor multiplets. These tensor multiplets have a scalar and a two-form. The scalar gives you a one-parameter space, the expectation value of it, and a two-form on it. Now the space of the space is going to be a three-dimensional torus, and so you choose a flat two-form, which means there are three choices you can make. The space becomes four-dimensional. So finally, you're back to sometimes four-n-dimensional space in this way. Finally, we're back to our object. We finally get a four-n-dimensional hyperkähler space, and the TD star geometry in this context is hyperholomorphic connections on a 4n-dimensional space with no reduction. So finally, we are at the highest level with the whole geometry back without any reductions. But instead of line operators, so previously in the context of 3D, we got line operators. But now, instead of line operators, we get surface operators. So if you take the boundary to be a three-dimensional torus, you can think about it as a product of a cigar times a T2. And at one point on the cigar, you fill in a two-dimensional operator, which wraps the whole T2. And so these are now what we call the surface operators. So then these have their own ring algebra, just like the chiral fields that I told you about. And then you get the generalization of this geometry to this 4D n equals to 1 theory. Sometimes something more subtle happens. In some cases, depending on the four-dimensional physics, we find that the four-dimensional TD star geometry is actually a non-commutative version of the hyperholomorphic connection and a non-commutative hyperkähler manifold. So we can get it a little bit more exotic, but anyway, I won't get more details of this. Okay, so here I have basically kept the total number of supersymmetries fixed at 4. I went from 2 dimensions, which is the old story, to 3 and 4 dimensions, and we saw that the TD star geometry basically get to be related to the unreduced version of Hitchin or the hyperholomorphic geometry. But you could ask, what about more supersymmetry? So an example of it is the familiar case of 4-dimensional n equal to 2 theory, which is also studied in the context of math, in the context of Donaldson-Witten theory, where, for example, Seibert-Witten equations come to give you a way to solve the problem. In that case, you have a four-dimensional theory with n equal to 2 supersymmetry. Now, so these theories are interesting for Seibert-Witten, for example, invariance for 4 manifolds. But they're also interesting for another reason, which is going to be my focus. They're also related to four-dimensional topological strings on non-compact Calabi-Yau manifolds. In other words, if you take a Calabi-Yau manifold, non-compact ones lead to four-dimensional theories with this much supersymmetry. So there's a link between Calabi-Yau manifolds, threefold, and this theory. So we want to connect that to the story. So this is a relation to Calabi-Yau to the topological string. So let me try to explain that. So as you're familiar, in the context of Gronwitten invariance, we study maps, holomorphic maps from a Riemann surface with boundaries to a Calabi-Yau with some Lagrangian, perhaps, where the boundary get mapped to the Lagrangian, and you map the whole thing holomorphically otherwise. And topological string can be embedded into M-theory in the following way. M-theory is a theory in 11 dimensions, we take a Calabria threefold, which occupies six of the real dimensions, and 6 plus 5 is 11, so altogether this space is 11 dimensional space. You have R4 times S1 times the Calabria. You take this background geometry. As you go around the circle, well, you take a circle reduction, the theory you get on R4 is an n equal to 2 theory of the type I was talking about in R4. So for some choice of x, you can, for example, get the cyber-width theory, which is useful to Donaldson invariants. But you can be more general and get different kinds of, depending on what you choose here, you can get different theories in four dimensions. So this is going to be our link between topological strings, which is the story of up here, to 4D physics, which is the TT star geometry down here. These three things are going to be linked together in this way. You can also take a Lagrangian submanifold inside X, and then for that to link into physics, you take the M5 brain geometries in the M theory, which is, corresponds to six-dimensional subspace in 11 dimensions, where you take a two-dimensional subspace of R4 times S1 times L embedded in this way, and in this way you can translate topological string problems into computational amplitudes into M theory. More precisely, as you go around the circle, you rotate the four-dimensional space by rotation parameters epsilon 1, epsilon 2. Namely, you think about R4 as two complex planes, and as you go around the circle, you rotate the complex plane by rotation angles epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. And these turn out, if you do that, this turn out to be related to the parameters of topological strings or Gromitian invariant. If you identify epsilon 1 with minus epsilon 2 with the coupling constant G string, which counts the genus of the Gromitian invariants. So this is a way to, so any computation doing Gromitian invariants for the non-compact Calabria case can be rephrased in this way. You can also do that for the compact case, but in the compact case, you usually just take epsilon 1 equals to minus epsilon 2. Now, I come back to the first half of my talk. How do you connect this to the story of the first half of my talk? Well, the question is, how do you do T star geometry for 4D n equal to 2? This has too much supersymmetry, and in fact, the theory, unlike the 4D case, unlike the half supersymmetric case, which had isolated critical points, this theory does not have isolated critical points. It doesn't have isolated vacua, so it has no mass gap, so it's not good in that sense. So what do we do to get some nice geometry? So there is a hint how to do this, and the hint comes from the following, from the large n duality of topological string, and that's because it turns out that if you take Lagrangian submanifolds inside the Calabria, they break the symmetry to half of it. So on the Lagrangian parts here that I was telling you about, on this part, you indeed get just 4 supercharges, the same number as I was getting in the context of TT star geometry. So on these guys, we're fine. So we can try to see what goes on this guy. But we do know that non-trivial Calabrias can be constructed starting from these guys by putting ND brains and doing what's called the large N transition. So by studying this guy, we can automatically get the answer for the closed one, and we will be done. So the large N duality relates the closed strings to the open strings, and open strings have half as much supersymmetry, and therefore we are done. So let me explain an example of it. So suppose you take R2 times S1 as your three-dimensional geometry, or in fact just R2, and take the Lambda-Ginzburg potential to depend on a parameter which is itself a connection on the Lagrangian submanifold. So take W to be a functional of connections on a Lagrangian submanifold. This you take basically this functional, which is the Chern-Simon functional on this Lagrangian submanifold with some parameter G string, and if you compute the topological string amplitudes for this theory, you end up getting simply integral of e to the w over gs, which is just the Chern-Simon amplitude, which we know, the open Gromov-Witten invariants compute Chern-Simon's amplitude. On the other hand, from the viewpoint of TT star I told you about, this is the usual period integrals, the naive ones. So I told you if you want to get the naive ones, you have to take zeta to 0. So in this case, you can make a contact with the Gromov-Witten invariants by taking the naive version of TT star. You take TT star and you degenerate it, you obtain the Gromov-Witten invariants or the Chern-Simon version. So in some cases, the relation between open string and closed string, this is familiar. So I gave you the Chern-Simon example. There are other examples that correspond to matrix models. So instead of Chern-Simon, in some cases, you get matrix models. And so the matrix integrals is the analog of those periods that you do to get the topological, in that case, what's called the topological p-model versions of these. So you can reformulate differently, but they all look like some kind of an integral like this with matrices or connections. But there is no mention of the twister parameter because the twister parameter is degenerated to zero. And in fact, the twister parameter would mix the holomorphic and anti-holomorphic moduli, whereas we know the topological string only depends on holomorphic moduli. So you have gotten rid of the anti-holomorphic pieces. So in the context of the topological strings, we somehow want to have T star back, the anti-holomorphic parameters. So you're like period integrals depend on T, but you want the T bar pieces to come in. This is not the same as the holomorphic anomaly that is familiar in the context of topological strings. In topological string, we have holomorphic anomaly, which means things almost entirely depend on T, but they're roughly a little bit of T bar dependence. This is actually a more democratic mixture between T and T bar. We're switching the complex, doing a rotation of zeta to zeta inverse, which flips the north to the south pole, flips the T to T star. So this is a kind of a total mixture of the holomorphic and anti-holomorphic degrees of freedom in the context of topological strings. So topological string, as I mentioned, is obtained from this data by taking a boring limit, so to speak. Zeta goes to zero. So an example of this, as I said, is like matrix models. You take these matrix models like this, take some potential as a function of parameters. You can go to these eigenvalues of the matrix, and you can write this as some integral over the eigenvalues with the measure factor having to do with the van der Waals. So you do these kind of integrals, and this actually is well known to give you the topological string models. Depending on what W you choose, you get different Calabi-Yau or mirror of Calabi-Yau. And so this is a familiar example. But this also looks like a Landau-Ginzburg period as of the type of that I told you about in the first part of the talk. But now we know this is not a good object to do because it's not causal homogeneous. Even if you took W as causal homogeneous, this mixes up the causal homogeneity because of this van der Waals. Therefore, this is not a good thing to do from the viewpoint of TT star, even though it's a good thing to do from the viewpoint of matrix models. As I mentioned, you can recover this version as a boring limit or a strange limit of TT star geometry, but it's natural to ask, what about the non-TT star version? Well, you can do the TT star version by restoring the twister parameter and setting it not to be zero. And you can do similarly when you, this actually turns out to be corresponding to the case where you get the usual topological string, which is the unrefined version. And you can also, the refined version, where you put the epsilon parameters, you get this van der Waals to the various powers. And as I just mentioned, you get the same thing by just doing the TT star geometry, where you put the van der Waals into the exponent, and you talk about the corresponding Landau-Ginzburg theory. Now, here I've talked about things which have a large and dual in terms of the matrix model or Chern-Simons theory. What about those which don't? Suppose I just talk about cases where they don't come from a dual to a large n. What do you do there? Well, it turns out that there's a way to do this, and it's related to what is called the Neprosov-Shalashvili limit of the theory. You start with the four-dimensional n equal to 2 theory, and you do something on it, which reduces it down to 2 dimensions. So the trick is this. You start with 4D, you do something between 4 to 2, which breaks half the supersymmetry, which depends on a parameter, which is called epsilon 1. And then you get a 2D theory with half the supersymmetry. And then you can study the TT star jumping 2D. Simple idea. So that's basically the idea. You start with 4D, break the supersymmetry to half, which depends on the parameter, and then do the corresponding geometry. This turns out to actually introduce, in addition to epsilon 1, an extra periodic variable theta. And in addition, we have, of course, the radius, the circumference of the cigar, r. So it depends on epsilon 1, theta, and r. This Neprosov-Shalashvili limit can be rephrased in a way which makes contact with the geometry of the four-dimensional Hilbert space and the ground states. And the idea is this. You see, you want to do a four-dimensional Hilbert space. What do? Well, it's going to be a three-dimensional torus. But three-dimensional torus has too much supersymmetry. Instead of that, what we do, we take a two-dimensional torus and a one-dimensional interval and we put some boundary condition on these intervals. On one side, we put what's called the brain of Oppert, some particular boundary condition. Another one, we put the Dirichlet boundary condition. This breaks half the supersymmetry, and we do TT star geometry for this geometry to get the answers I'm talking about. It will depend on this, the radii of this torus, epsilon 1 and r, and in addition, the theta, which corresponds to the twisted structure, the complex structure of this torus. So there's an extra parameter in this context. Now, so it's natural to see that we get a hyperkähler geometry because we start with the 4D n equal to 2 theory, and when you compactify it on a circle, in three-dimensional geometry, you get a hyperkähler geometry. Since we're going down on a circle of radius r, we can think about having a hyperkähler geometry. Indeed, if you study, for example, the Calabi-Yau's, the complex structure of Calabi-Yau, you have the marginal complex structures, but that comes equipped with the Jacobian variety on top of it, which together form a hyperkähler geometry. And so that's the hyperkähler geometry I'm talking about. In the context of Calabi-Yau, the hyperkähler geometry, or the mirror of the A model, if you're doing A model, will be a hyperkähler geometry that one is trying to study. And it turns out that studying TT star in this context boils down to quantizing this hyperkähler geometry. And for example, you get the Coulomb branch parameters, the parameters of the theory, of the base and the fiber, get quantized. So you don't get a continuous version, but you get discrete vacua corresponding to these values. So it's like having a Landau-Ginzburg theory, where instead of having a finite number of isolated points, you have an infinitely many critical points, but they form a lattice. And that's the lattice parameterized by an integer. And so if you want to get topological string, you just take the zeta goes to zero. And there are different limits that you can get to make contact with different objects. For example, in some particular limit, you can make contact with the constructions of Bioto, Moore, and Nitzky. And another way, you can connect it to topological strings. So it kind of unifies, on the one hand, hyperkähler geometric aspects of Calabi-Yau and the BPS states and the wall crossing on one hand, to topological strings on another hand, into one object. So this is the basic picture here. We have a basic object up here, which is gives you the analog of studying the TT star geometry. It depends on a parameter, which is how you break the supersymmetry from 4 to 2D. A radius and an angle, and a twisted parameter, zeta. And so I'm denoting the four-dimensional geometry here as a plane where you have this parameter epsilon 1 and the circumference r. And then there are two sides to how you reduce the theory. On one side, you get what is familiar for people who are studying topological strings, this side, this column. On another column, you get things which are more familiar to people who are studying hyperkähler geometry. So if you're interested in topological string, you take the analog of this twisted parameter to zero, and you make contact to the refined topological string or the Nikolsov-Chadashvili limit, depending on what kind of limits you take. On the other hand, if you don't make any reductions, in the hyperkähler geometry space, you automatically get the analog of coordinates on the hyperkähler geometry parameterized by these cohomology elements of the Calabi-Yau, which itself is in physics language what we call line operators, which don't form a commutative structure anymore. They don't commute, and they form a kind of a quantum torus algebra, but the Q parameter of the twisted algebra depends on the twisted parameters on R and epsilon and theta. So it's an extension that people usually don't have. Usually people just do the quantum parameter. Here it's a tutorial version of this quantum parameter. So indeed, if you go on this other column, you make contact with Conservi's Soivonen top wall crossing. And in fact, you make contact with the quantum version of it. If you take the epsilon 1 goes to 0 limit, this theory will depend on r and a theta, and a twisted parameter zeta. And then if you want to study this side, you make contact with the quantum Riemann-Hilbert problem. So you can reformulate. So this object is very hard to compute. But on this side, you can kind of reformulate what this object is in terms of a quantum Riemann-Hilbert problem. And here I just borrowed from our paper. I don't know if it's visible in it or not. Maybe it's not that visible back there. Anyway, I just want to show you the objects are not that trivial, but you can reformulate the idea of trying to compute this side is to first compute the geometry of these line operator, which they themselves satisfy an interesting jumping phenomena as you go, as you cross the rays where the BPS states come to be, where as you cross the rays of interest, the line operators jump according to the quantum dialogue or some versions thereof. So you get conjugated by the quantum dialogue operators. And so I write it like this, and you can solve this object. You can try to solve this object, and then you define the corresponding wave functions or the object of primary interest for us related to after you solve these line operators using such a data. This is related to the overlap of this wave function to some parameters. Anyhow, the story is a bit involved, but here I just want to show that there's a way to reformulate studying that limit in terms of the quantum Riemann Hilbert problem, where the jumps are given in terms of these quantum operators, quantum line operators. But there's also a version where you take theta to zero. So you see this is now the line operators are not commutative because of this theta parameter. If you take the theta parameter to zero, you get the line operators become the usual commuting coordinates of a hyperkähler jump. So by the time you come down here, you make contact with the usual Guyot-Moore-Knight's construction. And for example, if you were to try to compute supersymmetric QED, which means just the U1 4D theory with the one hypermultiplet, this is the thing that's familiar for the case of cyber-Newtonian geometry, for example, as monopole equations. The corresponding topological string you get can be constructed in this way. So this is in terms of what's familiar from the p-potentials of the usual conifold. And you get objects which are involved, dialogue rhythm and so forth, some integrals to do. Anyhow, in that case, it's actually solvable. This is one of the very few cases you can actively, explicitly compute everything. But in general, the story is very complicated. And as I was trying to emphasize here, there are very intricate links between them. You can go from one to the other or make different reductions. So the whole story gets complicated, but gets unified up here into one object. And that's the study of the Tiki star jump here, vacuum geometry. So I think I basically come up to the end of my talk. What I find most fascinating in the modern connection between physics and mathematics is that not only the manifold of connection between the subject is connected, but it's actually multiple connected in a very non-trivial way. And but more importantly, I would like to express my congratulations to Ron for his 60th birthday. Thank you.
Yes.
Theta is an extra parameter which is not there in the original theory, in the original theory of the topological strings. So in the geometry of the 4D, let me just bring it back. So when you say what is theta, I guess I have to ask in what context what is theta. So for example, here, I'm explaining what theta is. Namely, it's a complex structure of this torus. It's like parallelogram. If you have a rectangular one, there's no theta. If there's not rectangular, you get theta, that's all. Now, in another version, the theta is, let's see where we go here. Here, for example, oops. Here, when I talked about these quantum line operators here, you see this theta, that theta appears again. So, in some limit, when I take epsilon 1 to 0, this becomes constant. So this is the Q deformation, if you want to say in that language, of the wall crossing that you and Maxim studied. For example, that's the Q deform parameter. So you can think of it as that way. In the context of topological string, it doesn't appear. Why? Because in topological string, we take zeta goes to zero limit. And this piece dominates, not here. So people don't see it. In the context of usual topological string, people don't have theta. So theta appears only when you talk about the two-storial structure. So it's an extension. It's a triplet version of the parameter. Yes.
So how is this related to the story of the quantum Riemann Hilbert geometry on the hypermultiplet moduli space? Is this just the local Calabi-Yau story?
This is, I only talked about non-compact local Calabi-Yau, which is hyperkähler but not quaternionic.
And that's why you don't get these NSP.
Correct. That would be a much more complicated story. But I expect there to be a story there too, but in that case you cannot have you do not have two parameters, you just have one of them. Epsilon 1, epsilon 2, both do not exist. In order to do epsilon 1, epsilon 2, remember what I did. I went from five dimensions on a circle and rotated by two planes. Now, to do these independent rotations, you can only do it if there's a non-compact direction to compensate. Otherwise, you break the Calabi-Yau-Ricci flatness conditions. If it is compact, you have to make these rotations to be equal and opposite in direction. So that's SU2 holonomy.
So on the local Calabi-Yau case, like for example local P2, the topological straight amplitude is a polynomial with respect to Eisenstein series. So it's not a modular form, but it's a polynomial with respect to modular forms. Now if you enhance that with this twister parameter, what does it become modular?
Well, first of all, I haven't studied the P2, that specific case that you're saying. And I should say that, in fact, I don't know a single example where I can actually explicitly compute other than the supersymmetric QED I told you about. This is a very hard, I try to convey the statement that this is not a trivial object. Even for the boring x cubed plus ax case, the Palnabet 3, I cannot really have a strong handle other than it exists and this and that. This is a far more complicated version of that. So one can formulate abstractly what the theory would be and that there's a wall crossing phenomenon and this and that, but to actually compute it is very difficult. So I cannot answer it that easily.
When you relate concept solving and wall crossing to open string rings, I'm wondering how walls appear in the picture. I mean, your Lagrangians appear as knots. You have knots in curve. You take Lagrangians as normal bundles over the knots. Do you obtain those knots as kind of walls? Or
well, so what happens is this. So remember I told you about these guys. I said that when you're going back to 2D, you have these Lagrangian boundary conditions, which are these straight lines.
Yeah.
As you change the parameter, as you change zeta, which is the parameter which gives you a wall crossing, these actually rotate. And then you have the analog of the Picard-Lefschetz monodromy as these cycles hit each other. When you change these parameters, these deep range, these Lagrangian ones cross and you get different class. You have jumpings. So these things jump. So in other words, these sections that I was telling you about are not constant, are not continuous, they have jumps.
Okay.
So you get these jumps precisely because of the fact that these corresponding boundary data jump at specific values which correspond to BPS data.